Hello everyone, and welcome back to Tidal Gardens. I, like many people who get into the reef aquarium hobby, did so because of how peaceful and serene coral reefs are. The intense colors, the beautiful fish, tranquility. What's not to like about coral reefs, right? Well, this is a factory of lies. Underneath that veneer of peace and tranquility is a world of aggression and endless warfare between the corals and the reef. Fish, they're total jerks. Peace and quiet? Hell no. If I'm scuba diving, I can tell you blindfolded if I'm in a coral reef or not, because it is loud. It basically sounds like a bowl of Rice Krispies in your skull. But I digress. I get a little carried away there. This video, though, is all about coral aggression. It plays a big role in how we place corals and build up our reef tank. Let's get into it. Everything on a coral reef is trying to battle for more real estate, and the organisms on the reef developed specialized methods to wipe out their neighbors, whether that be other corals, algae, or inverts. You might be thinking, but wait, not everything is trying to kill each other. What about symbiotic relationships? And that's true to an extent. Years ago, I did a video all about symbiotic relationships, showcasing cooperation between very unlikely partners. One might get the idea that these sorts of things are common, but a coral reef is not some beautiful utopia. It's a landscape of intense competition for resources, and these symbiotic relationships only exist to further the competitive strategy of the partners. For example, let's look at the most iconic symbiotic relationship in the hobby, that between a clownfish and an anemone. In a vacuum, both the anemone and the clownfish would be better off alone. The clownfish is getting constantly stung by the anemone. It has just developed some degree of resistance. On the other hand, the anemone is being constantly battered by the clownfish and often getting its tips bitten off. But this relationship makes sense because the anemone provides protection to the clownfish from potential predators. And in return, the clownfish provides protection to the anemone from fish such as butterflies that might make a meal out of it. So there is a net positive from this relationship. This shows that even in cases of cooperation, it only makes sense in the context of competitive advantage. That was a little bit of a tangent, but it illustrates the point that every coral or invert we place in our tank has some mechanism of competition that they are more than willing to unleash on its neighbors. As responsible reef keepers, we should take that into account when deciding on both acquisition and placement. And that is what this video is really about. So let's start talking about what those mechanisms of competition are. First of all, corals possess nematocysts, or stinging cells. Nematocysts are used for both prey capture as well as defense. These venomous cells are not unique to corals, as they're found in anemones and jellyfish as well. Some organisms developed adaptations to acquire nematocysts when they can't produce them themselves. Zoanthid-eating nudibranchs, for example, eat the polyps and store the nematocysts in these sacs located on their back. That is why oftentimes the nudibranchs take on the coloration of the zoanthids that they've been feasting on. How they work is that each nematocyst is a pressurized capsule that features a coiled thread with harpoon-like spines. These cells are under a lot of pressure, so when they're activated, this coil fires out and stabs into the target and injects the venom. The power of the sting depends on the structure of the nematocyst, as well as the toxicity of the proteins that it's firing into the target. Some stings are very mild, while others are very intense. For example, the nematocysts from a pseudocoronactus mushroom are very sticky and it makes it able to grab on and hold large fish. In fact, these can easily stick onto your hand and you can lift the entire pseudocoronactus right out of the water. Most of the time, our skin is thick enough that coral stings really aren't that noticeable. But sometimes people are more sensitive to a particular coral. For example, some people are very sensitive to frog spawn and immediately break out after handling a colony. In extreme cases, people can get very ill. Some people are allergic to the venom from carpet anemones, and there have been reported deaths from allergic reactions. How this relates to coral placement is that some corals are able to create hyper-weaponized forms of tentacles called sweeper tentacles. A sweeper tentacle is a greatly elongated tentacle with a concentrated mass of nematocysts right at the tip. These sweeper tentacles are most commonly found in large polyp stony corals, such as Euphyllia, certain brain corals, Galaxia. The list goes on, but they are also found in small polyp stony corals, such as Pavona. If you have a coral that's capable of sending out sweeper tentacles, it's important to give it plenty of room in your tank because they can cause serious damage to neighboring corals. This is often easier said than done. Some corals can extend sweeper tentacles up to a foot away. Next up are two short-range weapons, mucus coat and mesenterial filaments. Mesenterial filaments are the inside guts of the coral that some species can expel onto the nearby adversaries. Mesenterial filaments contain nematocysts as well as digestive enzymes, and they too can cause significant harm by coating the target for hours. Eventually, the coral retracts these filaments, leaving behind a clearer substrate to grow upon. It's thought that mesenterial filaments used in this way are used for both aggressive expansion as well as nutrition for the coral when they're withdrawn back into the body. Oftentimes, this behavior happens at night, so it's entirely possible to have two corals situated close to one another be fine, but when you wake up the next day, one of them is completely dead, a victim of a mesenterial filament attack. Almost every type of coral is capable of extending mesenterial filaments, but some are more aggressive about it than others in this regard. I see them commonly in Favia, Favites, Pectinia, Hydnophora, and many types of chalice corals. This next point is a bit of speculation on my part, but it's been an observation of mine for years. Mucus coats on various corals can cause serious damage to other corals even after brief contact. The mechanism for this hostility isn't well documented, but it's pretty clear that whatever it is, it happens quickly. It's not uncommon for a coral to fall off of the rockscape face down on another coral, and both corals immediately start showing signs of damage. If left that way for a few hours, both corals could die outright. There are some studies that indicate the mucus coats of corals provide all kinds of benefits, such as UV protection, microscopic prey capture, and protection from detritus settling on the coral by periodically shedding the coat away. On the flip side, however, there's studies showing that this mucus coat is also a dense breeding ground for bacteria and viruses. Like I said, I'm not sure what makes the mucus coat of a coral tick, but in practical terms, it's important to place corals in such a way that you minimize the likelihood of contact, anticipate future growth, and make sure to place the coral securely so they don't lean into or, worse yet, fall on top of each other. The last coral aggression adaptation that I'm going to discuss in this video is chemical warfare. Some corals don't necessarily pack a mean sting or barf up their guts and dissolve their neighbors. Corals such as these toadstool leathers can secrete toxic compounds into the water that slowly poisons everything around it. How this manifests is that other corals around it, especially stony corals, simply stop growing. The secreted toxins are metabolites, which may include terpenoids, which are a super diverse group of natural compounds that are often associated with, like, protective oils, for lack of a better term. For example, some plants have this oily coat that makes them toxic to insects and other herbivores, or termites, have terpenoid-based oils that make them unappetizing to potential predators. These terpenoids are also precursors of polyhydroxylated steroids that have been detected as well from certain leather corals. There are also acetates and polyamine compounds that are all potentially bioactive. In fact, several of these compounds are being investigated for therapeutic uses because some are inhibitors of chemical pathways, which are very interesting in drug development circles. To sum all that up, corals are capable of excreting a cocktail of bioactive compounds in an effort to wipe out neighboring organisms. The corals associated most with these chemical toxins are leather corals like sarcophyton, lobophytum, limnalia, etc., etc. So what can we, as home hobbyists, do about corals that engage in chemical warfare? Some aquarists choose to avoid these corals altogether, especially those that are trying to create an SPS-dominated tank. A tank full of Acropora can be challenging enough without adding large corals that can stunt their growth into the mix. Having said that, there's plenty of people that can keep stony corals with leathers. It may not be ideal, but it can be done. There have been plenty of times that I've kept leather corals and Acropora in the same tank. Now, if you decide to try something like this in your reef aquarium, there are three techniques that can help. The first technique is to perform more water changes. By changing out water, this will serve to dilute the concentration of toxins that build up in the tank. The second method is running activated carbon. Activated carbon works by permanently binding up compounds through adsorption, adsorption with a D, which happens at the surface of the media. As the media fills up, it will have to be replaced, but honestly, activated carbon is inexpensive and readily available. The third and by far the least commonly used method is to run ozone in the tank. Ozone, or O3, is a highly reactive molecule that has powerful oxidizing properties. In an aquarium application, it's generated by an ozone machine, usually by passing oxygen through an electrical field, splitting up the O2 molecule, and then allowing those oxygen atoms to reform as ozone. In the aquarium, ozone has a variety of effects, such as clearing up the water, as ozone breaks down tannins that give our aquariums a yellow cast. It also virtually eliminates any tank odors. The effect that we're interested in, though, is how it affects the toxins that corals can emit. The extreme reactivity of ozone causes these toxins to break down upon contact to less harmful compounds with little to no bioactivity. Having said all that, there are severe downsides to ozone, such as safety risks if there is some manner of malfunction. If you're interested in trying ozone, as I am, be aware of the risks and have security measures in place to detect possible leakage of ozone into the air. Breathing in ozone is, in short, no bueno. All right, that pretty much does it for our discussion on coral aggression. To sum things up, corals developed all kinds of adaptations to gain a competitive advantage in the battle for real estate on the reef. In our home aquariums, we have to be conscious of these in order to find the best locations for them long term. All right, I hope you enjoyed the video. Please don't forget to subscribe and leave a like on the way out. Best of luck in your own tank, and I hope to see you all next time. Happy reefing.